Here is to you. An invitation. It is for you. A celebration. This is your day. Christ and will welcome you. There's no mistake. You are supposed to be here. And yes, he knows all you are going through. So he's prepared. Christ and will just for you. This is the place we lift up Jesus. This is the place we share.
Lord Jesus Christ gave us the quintessential definition of a true friend. He said, greater love has no one than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. In John the 15th chapter, somewhere around the 13th verse, he goes on to describe the quality of the relationship between he and his disciples. He says to them, you are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants because a servant does not have inside knowledge of his master's most intimate business. Instead, Jesus says, I have called you friends. For everything that I've learned from my Father, I have made available to you. Jesus, then, if you take these passage in its totality, Jesus, then, is that true friend that stick it closer than a brother. Can I get a witness, somebody? But fortunately, or unfortunately, as you may deem the case, that kind of friendship that Jesus is talking about is on a high plane. It's on a spiritually elevated level. What a friend we have. Yeah, obviously you know the song. But I'm not talking about friendship with Jesus, because for a human example of friendship, perhaps we should examine the relationship and the friendship between David and Saul's son, Jonathan, who, in spite of his father's, Saul's pursuit of David, and his concerted and dedicated attempts to kill David, Jonathan stood by his friend. His friendship with David actually cost him his shot at the kingdom. Saul said to his son, he was totally ticked off at his son, and he said, you stupid son of a perverse woman. Y'all thought I was going to go there, didn't you? You stupid son of a perverse woman. Do you not know that as long as the son of Jesse lives, you cannot be king? And so I come to inform you, my brothers and sisters, that there are 774,746 words in the Bible. But strangely enough, the word friend only appears 56 times. The Bible uses the word friend sparingly. I therefore think it is critical. Come on, somebody. I think it's critically important that we as believers scrutinize the people, come on somebody, in our lives who we allow to speak into and over our lives. I come to tell you this afternoon that everyone who pats you on the back and gives you a high five, kiss you and tells you they miss you is not your friend. Some people will grin and smile in your face, and all the time they're trying to take your place. And so then, brothers and sisters, If the person or the persons are going to be granted access into your personal business, or will be given the opportunity to speak into your life, you got to ask yourself, since she is a three-time loser in relationships, how is she going to advise me? Y'all ain't saying nothing. Now, if he or she can't run their own life, I'll be darned if I'll let them run my life. Can I get a witness, somebody? Unfortunately, then, some people that you let speak over your life are not actually qualified to give you an informed opinion. Come on, somebody. How can they give you an informed opinion regarding decisions that I'm getting ready to make, which will shape and perhaps even negate my date with destiny, if they don't know or have an informed opinion about the situation? Many, many years ago, there was a Secretary of Agriculture. His name was Earl Butts. And Earl got fired from his job for making a derogatory statement about the Pope. It had to do with the Pope's decision on birth control. And Earl said, in his best Italian imitation, he said, if he no play at the game, then he no make it the rules. Now, all Earl was trying to say is that if the Pope has never had sex, he can have an opinion, but it can't be an informed opinion. Y'all ain't gonna say nothing. Sometimes we take friendship for granted, or we get it twisted and don't really know what a friend is. I say to you again that just because you go out to dinner a few times does not a friendship establish. To be genuine and authentic, friendships have to go through some level of processing. That's why the Bible says that a friend loveth at all times, because that friendship was birthed and sustained in adversity. And so you have to ask yourself, does your friend really care about you beyond what they think you can do for them? Y'all ain't gonna like me today. And so the multitude, they loved Jesus as long as Jesus was multiplying the fishes and the loaves. But the moment that he challenged them and told them about their real motives, they departed from him. And no doubt, brothers and sisters, 8 months later, those who were fed the bread are now the same ones that are crying, "Crucify him." Human friendship is a fickle thing, you see. And then, brothers and sisters, I come to also understand that some people's friendship with you is based on a hidden agenda. And so you have to go beyond the surface and the plastic and the superficial in order to get to, somebody say, the hidden agenda. You see, brothers and sisters, Ahithophel, though he was the king's chief counselor, he has a hidden agenda against the king. What's that, Bishop Ford? Well, I've shared this with the congregation before, but perhaps I draw your attention again to an interesting connection between Bathsheba, with whom David had an adulterous affair, in 2 Samuel, the 11th chapter, and Ahithophel. In 2 Samuel, the 11th chapter, in verse number 3, Bathsheba is mentioned as the daughter of Eliam. But in 2 Samuel 23 and verse number 34, Eliam is mentioned as the son of Ahithophel. Hence, my brothers and sisters, Bathsheba is Ahithophel's granddaughter. Now, the motive is clearly seen for Ahithophel's defection from his loyalty to King David. It's because he is angry and disillusioned with David, after the Bathsheba affair and subsequent murder by proxy of her husband Uriah the Hittite, and who, by the way, is Ahithophel's grandson-in-law. And so it is quite evident that Ahithophel, though pretending to be David's friend, come on somebody, he carried a hidden agenda and a hidden offense against David. And so when the crises and the coup d'etat in the kingdom emerged, he easily switched sides and became the chief counselor to Absalom. Now, brothers and sisters, the strange thing about this is that for some reason, David was totally oblivious to Ahithophel's hidden agenda against him. When word came to David that the conspiracy was growing larger, this is not really what alarmed David. It was when they said, Ahithophel is leading the conspiracy. Psalms 55 picks up David's lament when he cries out, "For it was not an enemy that reproached me, then I could have borne it. Neither was he that hated me that did magnify himself against me. Then I would have hid myself from him. But it was thou, a man, my equal, my guide and my BFF. We took sweet counsel together and walked into the house of God in company. Yes, it was you, my brother, could have been no other. As I told you the secrets of my heart. And when I found out you lied and our friendship you denied, from this whole wide world I wanted to part." And so David, the people you think are close to you could be the same ones that someone tell somebody that might even burn you. Perhaps now you can see why I suggest to some people that you may need some new friends. Can I get a witness, somebody? Then you also have to ask yourself, does your friend's benevolence or generosity come with strings attached? In other words, if you bake me a cake or make me a peach cobbler, am I obligated to have an exclusive relationship with you and with you only? And does your culinary offering give you the right to pick my friends? Y'all ain't gonna say nothing. I told you you wasn't gonna like me today. Then, brothers and sisters, I think if we're going to have a true friendship beyond the attraction of the flesh, you also have to ask yourself, do you and your friend share the same values? Because the Bible says, how can two walk together except they agree? If we don't have the same values, baby, then perhaps we're not serving the same God. I want you to know today that I will try to cooperate with any force in my community to better my community. I can work in a collaborative effort with a Muslim for the betterment of my community, but my friends are going to be somebody that loves my God. Y'all ain't going to say nothing. Then I'm going to ask you to consider, is you and he or you and she's friendship able to endure, somebody say, honesty and transparency? You see, brothers and sisters, if I'm really your friend, but I can't tell you the truth without you accusing me of attacking you or abandoning you, come on somebody, then what kind of friendship do we have? Notice when I said this that I did not tell everybody else about your issue. No, I went to you and I told you just between you and I. What you've been doing and what you've been thinking about doing, it ain't right. I guess, brothers and sisters, what Bishop really wants to know is the quality of our relationship, is the quality of our friendship based on your insistence that I be a yes man in the relationship? And finally, brothers and sisters, when I face a crisis, or when you face a crisis in the situation and in your storm and in your demise, will I at that point kick you to the curb? If you fall, will I be there to pick you up? Because a true friend will stick by you in adversity. Do you know what God says, brothers and sisters? He tells us that the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. But he comes back and says, but if that good man shall fall, he shall not utterly be cast down. Why is that? For the Lord will hold him up in his hand. Now that's the Lord. The Lord will hold you up. But what about my friend? Will he hold me up? Will she hold me up? Will you lift me up after I have fallen down? Because in a true friendship, I know that you are for me. I know that you will hear me. I know that you will never forsake me, even in my weakness. And so the text tells us that Rehoboam is young, he's dumb, and he's full of himself. The truth of the matter is that he never intended to give any serious consideration to the advice of the senior elders. How do you know this, Bishop Ford? Because the scripture says that he did not take two divergent opinions and weigh the pros and cons of each one of them. But the Bible says that he rejected out of hand the sage advice and counsel of the elders. Brothers and sisters, I'm sorry, but would you allow me to give vent to some of my pastoral frustration? Come on, somebody. Because that's what ticks me off too. It's people and members who come and ask my advice on a multiplicity of issues. But the truth of the matter is that they've already made up in their minds before they came to me. They just want me to confirm what they done already made up in their mind to do. Come on, somebody. And they will allow me to be, quote, their covering as long as what I say matches up with what they've made up in their mind to do. They don't want a covering. What you need is an amen corner. What you need is a cheering section. Bishop, Bishop, what do you think I should do? Do what you want to do, Regin. Quit wasting my time. Hallelujah to God. And so here is the deal. Rehoboam is trying to impress his homies, and his homies is trying to impress Rehoboam. The only ones in this equation that will come up on the short side of the stick is the people of God. Listen now, brothers and sisters, and please, please don't get this twisted. The tradition of biblical, apostolic, theological integrity and purity that was passed down to us for generations and generations by our forefathers should never be changed or tampered with. You must be born again. You must repent of your sins and be baptized in that wonderful name of Jesus for the remission of your sins. And you must have that tongue-talking Holy Ghost. Yes, the Bible says that without the Spirit of God, you are none of his. The Bible tells you that you have to be baptized in Jesus' name. But brothers and sisters, conversely, let me just be honest with you. Some of the other stuff that our fathers passed down to us needs to be thrown in the garbage can. Some of the stuff that was passed down to us was just flat out wrong. And some of the things that our leaders did, though they were well intentioned, they were just wrong. Now, I'm telling you right now, love your bishop, honor, respect, and revere him or her. But know this, brothers and sisters, the bishop with all of his issues is not your God. And brothers and sisters, we bishops are fallible and we make mistakes. And I'm not the judge. I just communicate what the judge says. Yes. And so the truth of the matter is that Solomon was wrong for the heavy financial burden that he laid on the people in order to support all of his wives and their pagan gods. He was wrong when he forced the people of God to practice spiritual miscegenation, to mix and mingle the purity of the one God with the damnable doctrines of his idol-worshiping wives. The Bible explicitly informs us that when Solomon was old, his wives turned his heart away from God. When Solomon became oppressive towards God's people at the end of his life, I'm not even sure Solomon was still saved. Here is a man who has given himself completely over to multiple idolatries. Here is a man that has everything but can't find it within himself to give God glory for anything. Here is a man who says that all is vanity and vexation of spirit. And brothers and sisters, I'm of the opinion that even if Solomon was saved, I'm quite sure that he was not sane. Y'all ain't saying nothing. I said even if he was saved, he was not sane. For he had 700 wives and 300 concubines. That's enough to drive any man crazy. Y'all ain't gonna say nothing. No. Some carnal brother said to me long time ago, thinking of his lascivious delights with 1,000 women. He said, oh, brother, but what a way to die. No, brother, 1,000 women is not paradise. That's hell, baby. Notice now that the elders, they never said a disparaging word about the dead king. Even though they knew Solomon was wrong and had lost his way, they still respected his authority. All they were advising the young king was that it would not take much for you to recapture the hearts of the people of God. Rehoboam, they said, if you just showed a little TLC, a little tender loving care, and let the people know that you really care about them, your kingdom would be established forever. But Rehoboam rejected the counsel of his elders and rather took the advice of his so-called friends. Friends that told him that whatever he wanted to hear. Friends that don't even like him and later on will stab him in the back. Friends whose advice just on the surface level seems to me to be a little bit over the top. Friends who may not even be saved. You'd be surprised how much influence unsaved people have with the people of God. I told you earlier in this message, make sure that you and your friends share the same values. Really, brothers and sisters, when I examine the ministry and the kingdom of Rehoboam, though Rehoboam is young and inexperienced and impulsive and really don't know what is a true friend, Rehoboam really turns out to be a pretty good king. Can I get a witness, somebody? Now, brothers and sisters, we know that the redactors of the scriptures, they toned down the statement that his friends had given them. They translated the text for the literal translation of this passage, my little finger is thicker than my father's loins, is quite different from what he actually said. What the friends actually advised was, my pecker is a lot bigger than my daddy's pecker. Because back then, brothers and sisters, there was a belief among the male-dominated society that there was a direct correlation between strength and virility and penis size. The young men's friends are advising Rehoboam, tell the people, I got the balls to do stuff that my daddy would not do. What's wrong with that statement, Bishop Ford? Well, besides being overly graphic and disrespectful to the people of God, the friends show where they believe that their power comes from. I don't care how big and what you got down there. You may be Mandingo Warrior, baby, but you still need God. Can I get a witness, somebody? And you must depend upon God. All of my help, it comes from the Lord. All I'm saying as I get ready to take my seat is don't question yourself and don't question God. Tell somebody you may just need some new friends. Quit letting people stop your wells up, baby. Quit letting people stop your wells up. Some folks perpetrate and call you their friend to your face, but behind your back, they don't have your back. Quit wasting all your energy and talents trying to get people to like you, trying to get people to accept you. I want you to accept yourself for who God made. You are a unique human being, baby. Ain't nobody on this earth like you. I know I can't preach like Jakes. I know I can't preach like Gates. I know I can't preach like Noel or Joel, but can't nobody beat me being me, baby. Be yourself. Yeah, they may all continue to espouse the BFF virtues together, but baby, if there are cracks in the collision and in the cohesion, rather, you need to ask yourself, do I really need to be in this group? Tell your neighbor you may need some new friends. You don't need to be tense all the time and stressed out all the time. Get yourself some new friends, because some of your friends, I just come and tell y'all today, some of your friends got a hidden agenda. Well, God told me to tell you, all you got to do now, don't get upset, don't fall out of the race, don't change churches, don't let nobody run you away from your church. Just get yourself some new friends. Hey, glory to God. Get yourself some new friends. I ain't going to be controlled by you. I ain't going to be bullied by you. I'm just going to get me some new.
Temple Academy Daycare and Learning Center is currently enrolling children 6 weeks to 12 years of age. Our professional staff is dedicated to provide a safe, fun-filled learning atmosphere. Temple Academy offers services during the spring, summer, and winter breaks. Temple Academy also accepts 4C's applicants and offers a child referral incentive program. Call today to transform your child's daycare experience from ordinary to extraordinary.